Good evening. I want to start off tonight by posing a question for you to consider for yourself, which is, what brave step am I willing to take to create the life and the career that I want? Now, how many of you here are in some sort of a career transition of sorts? Okay, like everybody. Okay, so everybody's thinking about, you're at some sort of a crossroad. How many of you are at some sort of a crossroad in your career? Okay, good, you're in the right place tonight because we're going to talk about how to navigate career change. And my objective tonight is to provide you with the clarity, the confidence, and the courage to be able to pursue more meaningful work. And what I mean by that, what I mean by meaningful work, is being able to look yourself in the eye, in the mirror, every single day, and to be able to say, hey, this work matters to me, or this work matters to other people, or this work matters to the world. So that's the objective tonight, and hopefully you'll get a chance to walk out of here with some questions answered that you have about career change. And we're going to walk through four areas tonight. I've got you for about 45 minutes, and if you've got any questions throughout, if you could just jot them down and hang on to them until the very end. We'll have some time for questions at the end. Four parts to today. So the first thing I want to do is give you an overview of my own career change story. And the reason why I want to do that is so that you can get a sense of, first of all, what does a career change trajectory look like? And also so you can get a sense of the three questions that I asked myself when I was trying to clarify those pivotal moments in my career change trajectory. The second thing I want to do is to walk you through the seven stages of career change. Now, why walk through the seven stages of the career change? It turns out that there's a predictable trajectory amongst people who are thinking about relaunching their careers. And in talking with a lot of people, both audiences here, my clients, and really speaking to hundreds of people who have navigated career change, there are some patterns that come up, and predictable patterns. And so I want to help you try to understand where you are on your own career change trajectory, because the first thing to figure out where to go next, to first of all figure out where you are right now. It's like hitting that button on your mobile phone that kind of places you, well, where am I right now? I got to figure that out to figure out where I want to go from here. Then I want to walk you through some of the career change myths out there. So four common career change myths that I hear come up again and again. And this is to give you an idea of what it takes to make a career change and what's really involved. Like what does it really look like when you want to relaunch your career? Because I think part of navigating career change is being able to understand what are you in for when you go for a career change. And then the final thing I want to do is wrap up by sharing a bit of a snippet from some profile pieces I've done as part of a podcast that I host called Career Relaunch, where I interview a lot of different people who have navigated career change, and just to share with you some of the best practices, some of the things that I see people do again and again that allows them to relaunch their careers in ways that people aren't able to do if they don't do these things. So I'm going to share a few tips with you so you can walk out of here with some concrete steps, some concrete principles of what tends to work for people if they want to successfully change careers. Okay, so that's tonight. And I want to start off by sharing with you a very brief snippet of my own career story. And how many of you have ever been asked the question, what do you do? Anybody been asked that question, what do you do? Anybody been asked that question tonight, what do you do? Oh, nobody. You probably will before you leave the end of tonight. There's networking afterwards, by the way, so we can stick around for that. The equivalent of being asked, what do you do when you're a child is, what do you want to be when you grow up? And this is a picture of me when I was about 5 years old in Hamilton, Ohio. And the thing that I wanted to be when I wanted to grow up was a doctor. And I decided this pretty early on. I won't go into the whole story tonight. I do talk about it more in my TED talk. But the point is that I spent a lot of time investing in this career path. So I spent the next 19 years, elementary school, high school, college, trying to get into medical school. And it turns out in 2002, I actually did get into medical school. I matriculated to the Georgetown School of Medicine in Washington, D.C. And it was one of those moments where I felt like I had invested so much time trying to achieve a goal, and maybe you've been in that scenario where you invest so much to try to get somewhere, and then when you get there, you just don't feel like that's where you want to be. How many of you have ever had that happen? You reach a point, you reach a destination, you're in the wrong place, right? This is exactly what happened to me when I got to medical school. Within the first day, I started to feel like I was completely out of place. And it was actually in gross anatomy class where people were dissecting their cadavers that I started to realize, wow, this just isn't me. And I looked around and I just felt like I completely was out of place. I describe it almost like you're trying to pull a shoe on that doesn't fit. And no matter how hard I tried, it just didn't fit. And so the problem here was I'd invested so much time trying to get to this point. And the question is, well, what do you do once you've invested in a career path and you realize that it's not right for you? And I remember talking to my father and mother about this, telling them that, hey, maybe I'm not going to go through this whole thing. Maybe I'm going to walk away from this. And they were both quite supportive. I do remember my father saying, well, you can do this, and I will support your decision, but your life's going to be a big mess if you do this. And with that in mind, I actually had to face the first pivotal question, which I would encourage you to think about if you're on the cusp of making a change, which is, do I finish what I started, or do I cut my losses and move on? And for me, I felt like this wasn't right for me. And so I actually decided to quit. So after 2 weeks of medical school, I actually quit the program. So I went from being one of the 1% of students that get into one of the 3% of students that actually drop out. So I kind of went on this great trajectory, and suddenly I'm this big failure in my career. And what I tried to do at that point was try to kind of find my way. And my dad was definitely right. My life was a big mess for a while. I fumbled around for a bit. I tried to kind of pick up the piece and figure out what to do. So I actually was an administrative assistant at a law firm just to kind of make ends meet. And then after that, I went and worked for the National Institutes of Mental Health, which is where I had interned 4 years ago. And they were kind enough to give me a fellowship there, again, just kind of to make ends meet. I became an EMT. I'm going to talk about this later. I was actually experimenting with the idea of going back to medical school, which sounds crazy, I know. But sometimes what happens is when you leave something behind, your first instinct is to actually go back. And that's what I started to do. So I started, well, maybe it was Georgetown. Maybe it was the school I was at. Maybe it wasn't medical school. So I'm going to try to become an EMT, and maybe that'll kind of refuel my passion for medicine. I hated being an EMT, and so I put that aside. I actually even taught salsa classes for a while. So I kind of went through this like renaissance. So this is at a Cuban club in Washington, D.C. Excuse the shirt that I think that was in at the time. But I kind of went on this renaissance, and people go through this when they're going through career change. They kind of go on this renaissance and exploration when they're trying to figure out what to do. And eventually, I kind of found my way. So a new chapter began, and I ended up finding myself in a health policy firm, and that's what planted the seed to my eventual career in brand management, where I would spend the next 10 years of my career. So I went and got my MBA at the University of Michigan. A new chapter began for me. I then moved on from there, and I marketed trash bags, which is the first brand that I worked on at the Clorox company in the Bay Area. So this is just outside of San Francisco. I know other people have taken product shots like this if you're working on a brand. Okay, so yes, we do take pictures like this in the corporate world. Things were going great. I was going to cool events. I liked my team. This is my team. At this point, I was marketing drain opener of all things. And yes, it got better and better. And things were going great. I was on track for promotion. But there was one small wrinkle in this whole thing. Right here is a picture of my then girlfriend, now wife, who was in the UK at the time. We'd met in an airport of all places as we were both flying from Istanbul to London when I was visiting my sister, who used to work in Istanbul. And so we were long distance this whole time when I was in business school and she was doing her PhD out here. And so I had this little sheet of paper over here, which I always recommend people do this. I put my top three goals for the year, and one of those goals was to find a way to get to the UK, no matter what, within the next year. And the problem was, I was on track for promotion, things were going really well at the Clorox company, and I was faced with another question, which is, what decision allows me to live without regret? And this is what I would encourage you to think about. If you're toying with the idea of leaving something behind, even though it might compromise your professional life, maybe for your personal life, but what's the decision that is going to allow you to live without regret, without having to look back and feel like you're having to kick yourself? Because that's the kind of thing that people try to avoid. For me, I ultimately decided that I wanted to prioritize my personal life. So I moved to Nottingham, which I still mispronounce to this day, and moved to the UK to be with my then girlfriend. I picked up where I left off, eventually worked for the Goop Hoods company in London. And this is one of the first events that I went to when I got here. It was a Lily Allen event that was organized. And then things were going well. Same thing, going to cool events, was working on luxury foods and luxury dessert, was with much more of a passion of mine, the food industry. It was around this time that I started to get that same feeling of, gosh, do I really want to spend the rest of my life getting people to eat more dessert? And so I went through this phase of, well, maybe Goo isn't for me. Maybe this isn't the right company for me. Maybe I need to go back to a bigger company where there's maybe more options outside of the dessert category. But I ended up landing at General Mills working on Häagen-Dazs, which is another luxury desserts brand. So now it's about getting people to eat more ice cream. And I went through this process, and eventually I landed at this corporation. I took more pictures with life-size photos of products, and I was kind of drinking the Kool-Aid, as they say, and finding it to be reasonably enjoyable, but there was still this sort of lingering doubt in my mind of, is this really what I want to be doing? And there's a picture of me sitting at my desk on a weekend, actually. And my wife actually came with me to work because I had to go in for several weekends in a row. And if you've ever had to do that, it gets you thinking about where your career's going. And I had just gotten married, and I was starting to reflect on, gosh, is this really what I want to do with my life? And at that moment, actually, tragedy hit. My father, actually, a few months after I got married, passed away. And it was one of those moments where it kind of just made the world stop around me, and I kind of just wondered, gosh, what am I doing? Like, life is flying by. I'm doing this work that I don't really care about. And I remember going onto the train, going from Sacramento back to San Francisco. I was flying back to London. There's a picture I took out of the back of the train. And I went past the Clorox building to the SFO airport. And this kind of felt like my career. It's like you're going down this track. And you are going forward in some direction. But is that the direction you really want to be going? And that was the problem. I came back to London, went back to work a few days later. I'm sitting in the General Mills cafeteria here doing some work. And the question is, well, how long will I tolerate doing work that I don't really care about? And that's the question for you. If you have come here tonight, you probably came here because you're thinking about making some sort of a shift in your career. And the question I'd encourage you to think is, how long are you going to tolerate doing work you don't really care about? And this ultimately got me thinking about what was next for me. At the time, what was really funny was I also spotted this article in the Onion magazine, which is actually a satirical publication in the United States, and it says, find the thing you're most passionate about, then do it on nights and weekends for the rest of your life. And this is exactly how I felt, because at the time I was also enrolled in this coaching program here in London. I was interested in coaching. I developed that passion in the corporate world, actually, mentoring and coaching other people. So I enrolled in this coaching course, absolutely loved this, really didn't like my day job. And I had to kind of think about what my whole career was about and what I believed in. And when I was coaching other clients, this is something that I told them, which was making the effort to create more meaning in your life is absolutely worth it. And yet, I was going into a job during the days when I wasn't coaching people that I didn't find that meaningful. And that seemed incongruent to me. And it's hard to be incongruent with the things that you're professing to other people. So I ultimately decided to leave the corporate world, and I left my corporate job behind, and this is now my focus. My focus now is on helping other people relaunch their careers. And my vision when I left the corporate world and left my brand marketing job was to try to take the principles of building and relaunching brands and products and companies and apply them to help people build and relaunch their personal brands and relaunch their careers and relaunch their lives. And so my work now spans three areas. So I do some speaking, which is what I'm doing right now, just to inform people of what it's like to make career changes and how to rebrand yourself. I also do some coaching, just one-on-one coaching with people. And the last piece is I actually do curation. And this is where I'm gonna spend the rest of my time talking today, because I actually see myself and part of my job as being a curator of stories, almost like somebody who's got a art exhibit. You're kind of curating portraits that you think are worth seeing for other people. I see myself as a career curator. And so in talking to people, in connecting with audiences, in interviewing people for my podcast, and doing coaching, I start to see patterns that come up. And I think there's a lot of value and insights in learning from other people. And so what I'd like to do now is take you through what those patterns are that I see in people, and maybe you can try to identify where you sit on this career change journey for yourself. And I call this the seven stages of career change. And it's kind of a roadmap. And the question is, well, why have a roadmap? Well, the reason for a roadmap is it kind of helps you pinpoint exactly where you are. And these are some of my rough notes when I was taking them early on about some of the patterns I started to notice in people. And it started to reflect almost the patterns that people go through when they're dealing with loss, which if you come from a psychological background, you know denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and then acceptance. And there was a similar trajectory I was seeing with people who wanted to leave their jobs behind to pursue something else. And the first step I found that's really useful is try to pinpoint where you are. Again, if you pop out of the tube here, the first thing you got to do is figure out where you are before you can figure out where you want to go. So I want to try to help you try to do that tonight. And what I did was, when I was coaching people, I would notice people saying very similar things across different sessions. And I would try to just capture those after every session. I would just put them in different places. These are the different emotions people are going through at different stages. And that eventually turned into this roadmap, which is the 7 stages of career change. We're just going to go through this very quickly, which is, and hopefully this will be useful for you. You can kind of figure out where you sit on this. First of all, the status quo. Okay, now status quo probably doesn't apply to anybody here, because if it did, you probably wouldn't be here. Status quo is, I'm pretty content with my job. Like, there's nothing really wrong, there's nothing really right, but I'm fine with it. I can live with this. The next thing that comes up, though, is doubt. And this is normally the point at which people are saying things like, I don't like my job. Now, I don't know if it's my entire industry or my company, but what I do know is I'm not really feeling it with my job. What happens after doubt is dismay. You go from not liking my job to, actually, I've now realized I don't even like my career. I don't like anything about my career. I don't like where it's going. I don't like the company I'm working for. I don't like the culture. I don't like how I'm spending my days. And so this is that moment where you feel like, wow, I'm in the wrong place. And this is what I felt when I was in medical school, actually, this moment of dismay. What can happen, though, after this is this phase of mitigation. And this is where I'm guessing people will start to enter in here, the people in this audience, is this point of the career change roadmap, which is mitigation. Mitigation is what I was doing when I was trying to take that EMT course. Mitigation is when I switched from one desserts company to another desserts company, thinking that, okay, well, maybe it's just the company. That's what mitigation is. It's trying to come up with some solution, or me taking a coaching course on the side. It's like, okay, well, I'm not feeding my passions at work, but maybe I can feed them outside of work. Maybe it can be a little side gig of mine, the evenings and weekends thing. That's mitigation. And a lot of times people get caught at this point, or they'll come back to this point. What happens is if you do enough of this, you end up getting really tired, okay? And so you can go from maybe I can fix this to actually, you do enough of this, I'm exhausted. I'm totally spent. I can't keep doing this. I can't keep balancing this side project, this side hustle with my full-time day job, because actually that's just physically and mentally exhausting me. I just can't keep doing this. Okay, so people say, well, gosh, this isn't working. And so what happens is eventually people say, well, enough is enough, and they end up departing. This is when people resign from their jobs, or they'll move on. And maybe they'll move to another company as part of the mitigation. But when I'm talking about departure, I'm talking about a clean break from what you've been doing before to go do something else. So people say, gosh, I can't go on like this. This is that, hey, I won't tolerate this anymore. I can't live like this anymore. I won't wake up every day and hate it being Monday. Okay, I won't wake up every day and hate that the alarm clock is ringing. Like, I want there to be a different existence for myself. Departure is really important, because this clean break actually allows you to have some space for something else in your life. And what happens is people go into a bit of a reflection period. So sometimes people will go into this period where they'll go through what I went through was a little bit of a renaissance, where you're exploring a lot of different things, or you're kind of actually detaching yourself from other people, getting yourself away from your former colleagues so you can have a fresh start. This is sort of like a palate cleanser between meals. Okay, it just gives you a chance to reset. So you go to this place where I need some space. And finally, now that I've left my job, I have the room, I have the mental capacity to really think about this stuff. And you do this, and hopefully what happens after this, although I would say people, this takes a long time, this is not easy to navigate. People end up going to this phase, which is where we all want to get to, which is the relaunch, which is, hey, I'm going to go do this. I think I've got enough information now. I think I've got enough confidence where I'm going to go do this thing that I've been thinking about doing for so long, finally. And generally what I hear from people when they go to relaunch is a huge sense of relief, because they're finally doing that thing that actually resonates with them. So it's not as much excitement as it is just this huge weight lifted from your shoulders. So what I'd like you to think about is, where are you on this career change path? Out of curiosity, let me just see, where should I? How many of you are just, if you're able to raise your hands, okay, I mean, I don't know if you have colleagues here or not, so maybe don't if you do, but how many of you at this exhaustion phase where you're just tired of balancing it? Just tired, okay. Anybody here just do the departure? Okay, so we got a couple people there. Anybody here at the reflection stage? Okay, so a lot of reflectors. Anybody here at the mitigation stage, where you're still trying to kind of find a way to make it work? Okay, great, so we have quite a mix of people here. And maybe what you can do afterwards is try to find somebody else who's in your little bucket here, and maybe you can connect and exchange some notes and some tips on how you're navigating through it. Okay, so hopefully this gives you a sense of where you are on this journey. What I'd like to do now is talk about some of the myths of career change. And the reason why I think this is so important is because sometimes people try to make a career change and they get into it and then they start to realize, wow, this isn't what I had in mind. I was totally wrong about what this is going to involve. And I think half of the battle is knowing what you're getting into. So I'm going to share with you four myths that I hear come up all the time and debunk them and give you a reality check on what actually happens. This isn't just my own story, but just from hearing other people go through career change. And hopefully this will give you a sense of, gosh, do I have the stomach for this or not? Okay, and I think if you do, then I would go for it. Okay, so let's start with the first one. Before we get into that, this is what has fed into the section that I'm going to share with you now. So the myths and then also some of the enablers later. This is just a sampling of some of the guests that have either already been featured or will be featured on Career Relaunch. And I've learned so much from these people. And one of the real privileges of my work right now is I get a chance to really understand what's behind the emotions and the rationale for what drove people to make their changes. And I get to hear their stories, which is a real privilege. And so in talking to these folks, some themes have emerged that consistently come up again and again in terms of the myths of career change and how they navigated through them. Okay, so the first one is that career change is this logical, natural evolution. That actually, this is some natural path that you're going to go on. And when the moment is right, it'll just kind of happen on its own. The truth of the matter is this rarely happens. There is really nothing logical about changing careers. Because if you talk to most people, and probably most people in this room, you've invested time, energy, you've built up relationships, you've built up a reputation in your industry. The idea of walking away from all that and leaving all that behind to start over, that's not that logical. And in fact, most of the people who end up doing this go through some sort of a disruptive change. And it reminds me of this quote by David Lloyd George, and he says, there are times you need the courage to take a great leap because you can't cross a chasm in two small jumps. So the truth of the matter is, if you want to make a major change, it is often a bit of a leap of faith, and it's not going to feel natural to you. So if you're thinking about making a change and it feels really uncomfortable, that's because it is really uncomfortable. I don't know anybody who's gone through a change where it just says, wow, this was just smooth sailing all the way through. It just rarely happens. Okay, so that's the first myth I want to debunk. The second myth is that the only solution is a drastic change. So sometimes what happens is people get really fed up and they think, I got to change everything. I got to change. If you think about your career, it's made up of a few different things. The industry, geography, the sector you're in, the role you have, the company you're at, the culture you're in. And they think, you know what, I'm going to scrap all that. I'm sick of this. And they just take this kind of escape route. And maybe if I just throw this all out, I can do something different. It'll be a lot better. So this is kind of the counterpoint to what I just said, which is you don't always have to make a major change. Some of the people I've spoken to have become really happy again by just making a small tweak in their careers. They just change their role, or they change the type of project that they're on. So before they go make this major leap, they actually try to see if there's a way to fix it. This is that mitigation phase where actually the mitigation works out. And this reminds me of a guy, Tony Robbins, okay, who's this like big coaching guru guy, all right? And he gave this talk about golfing and how, I don't play golf, but he talks about this 1 millimeter rule. And he says that when you're golfing, if you just turn the club just 1 millimeter, it just sends the ball in a completely different direction. Or you imagine you're on a boat or a canoe or a ship, and you just turn just 1 degree, and suddenly you're in a totally different direction. So it's possible that just making a minor tweak can make the difference. You may only be 1 millimeter off in your career. And the only way to figure that out is to try to test some things out. Okay, so before you go make that leap, maybe there is a way to fix it. Okay, myth number three is that career change creates this immediate moment of triumph. Okay, this is the what I see on Instagram feed phenomenon, okay, or what I see on social media, which is like the person who's left their corporate job and you see this nice hashtag no filter picture with them sitting by the lake with their laptop, with their MacBook, okay, and their iPhone and their latte and their journaling pen, okay, and it seems like, wow, they've made it, okay, wow, everybody wants to do this, it's fantastic. that generally isn't what happens, okay? What generally happens is that the unbeaten path is often the very lonely one. The moment you decide you want to go do something else, you can expect a bit of disenfranchisement from all of your former colleagues and all the people who you used to know in your industry, because they're not going to know what to do with you. Because here are the people who have decided that this career is for them, and you want to try to talk to them about what you're planning on doing. It's not going to comport with them. Okay, so you may find yourself getting disenfranchised from social groups, from professional groups, from your colleagues, the moment you decide you want to go do something else. And it could be a very lonely journey for a while. I run my own business, and I'll tell you that there are days where it's incredibly lonely. There are days where it's not, like days like today, but sometimes it's a really lonely, independent journey where you really don't have anybody you can turn to. The final myth I want to talk about is that you must have a complete, fully mapped out plan before you move on. Now, have any of you taken the Myers-Briggs test? Okay, so I've taken this multiple times, okay, and in multiple teams, I'm consistently the one who is the most extreme planner on the team. Okay, this happened across three different companies when I've taken this test, okay, and I think I've got a couple former colleagues in here, they may attest to that, okay? So I am a planner. I love plans. I love to know, you know, I'm not the person who travels and books my hotel once I land, okay? It's done 5 months in advance, okay? I feel much more comfortable with the plan. So I get that planning is really important, and I feel more comfortable when I have one. However, this can also end up being the thing that blocks people from ever making a change. And this comes up all the time, is that people say, okay, I want to go explore this new career, but I don't exactly know what it entails, so I'm not going to go do it. But in order to know if that's the right career for me, I need to go and do it. So it's this sort of chicken or egg thing, like what comes first? Do I go start first, or do I map it out first and know what I'm doing before I actually make the move? And what happens is I'll check in with these people a year or two later, and they're still in the exact same spot. The people who end up making it, from what I've seen, are the people who take one small step in broadly the right direction, because they know that they are precisely in the wrong spot right now. So you take a step in broadly the right direction, and then they take another step in broadly the right direction, and eventually over time they find their way. And this reminds me of the Steve Jobs quote from his Stanford University commencement address, which is, you can't connect the dots looking forward, you can only connect them looking backwards. You have to trust the dots will somehow connect in your future. And that's what I'd encourage you to keep in mind, is that even if you don't have this whole thing mapped out completely, maybe you could take one step that will help inform what the next step is going to be. So a lot of times I'll hear people say, well, I don't know where to start when it comes to, for example, in my industry, coaching. Like what school do I go to? Like, do I even need to get certification? And what I tell them is, well, what's the next micro action you could take to move you one step closer to that? Well, maybe it's, what's the very first thing? Well, I need to go and explore. I need to go research which schools might be good. Or I need to go talk to somebody who might have already been a coach and ask them what might be best. Like, what's one small digestible action you can take that's feasible for you, that's not too much, that's not too daunting? Okay, so the reflection for you right now is, what's stopping you from making your change? Is it one of these things? The need to have a plan before you move on? The need to have everything completely mapped out before you make a move? Like, what is it that's stopping you? Because normally it's one of a few things, whether it's investment or the reputation you're letting go of or the credibility you might lose by moving on. It could be money. It could be status. There's a few common things that come up, but I think it's really important to understand, well, what is the thing that's standing in your way so you can identify that barrier and then figure out, how do I get over that barrier? So you kind of know what you're dealing with. So to give it a name, to identify it, to clarify what that barrier is. Okay, so then the last thing I wanted to share today was just some enablers of change. And then afterwards, we'll have some time for some questions. So enablers of change. So let's say you understand where you are in the career map. You understand what's involved. How do you actually make a change? Like, what does it take to overcome the barriers to change? And this is where I'm going to turn to a few of the people who have featured on this podcast for some of their wisdom and some of the common patterns that I see coming up again and again that they've mentioned. So I'll capture who these people are, and I'll capture a quote from the podcast, and then hopefully it'll be really clarifying for you. So when I think about change, there are certain components. There's three components that actually fuel change. And the first one is clarity. Now, clarity is really important because it gives your life and your career intention. It allows you to be proactive and in control when you're making your next step. So being clear on what you want, being clear on what you don't want. Clarity to me is so important because it allows you to kind of rule things out. It allows you to not be completely random about your next step. The next thing is confidence. And the reason why confidence is so important, it goes back to that point about running into people who may not buy into your idea. You are going to run into naysayers, you're going to run into critics, you're going to run into people who think what you're doing is crazy. And it requires a certain amount of confidence and almost this sort of unabashed, unapologetic belief that the direction you're going in is correct for you and that it is right for you. And that requires a certain amount of self-confidence to be able to fend off that judgment that will inevitably come your way. Okay, second piece is confidence. The third piece, which is a little more touchy-feely, is courage. And the reason why courage is important, it goes back to that point about needing to make a leap. And what I've found is that oftentimes, even though mitigation can work, normally when people are unhappy in their careers, little incremental changes aren't normally enough. Normally, it requires a slightly more courageous step that will create a more significant change in somebody's career. So courage is really important. So for each of these, I've got a couple suggestions on clarity, a couple on confidence. I got three ideas for you on courage, and then that'll be all I've got for today. Clarity. Well, how do you get clarity? Well, the first thing to do when you're thinking about clarity is, first of all, clarify what matters. And this, again, is where I see people get stuck sometimes. When you think about, I like to think of your career in chapters. And so if you think about the chapter you're on right now, in the next chapter of your career, if you're feeling stuck, what is the most important thing that I must have, at least in the next chapter of my career? I don't need to have it for every chapter from here on out, but just for the next chapter of my career, what's important to me? Because you oftentimes can't have everything. So is it work-life balance? Is it doing work I care about? Is it earning more money? Is it being able to live closer to my workplace so I don't have a two-hour commute every day? Like, what's that one thing that is a non-negotiable? And getting clear on that. This guy's name is Julian Mather. He's based in Brisbane. He's one of the guests I featured on the podcast. He's a former army sniper who's now a children's magician. Okay? I mean, talk about a career change. He went from being an army sniper to being a photographer, actually. And the way he describes it in the podcast is, well, you know, you're just shooting one thing in one case and another thing in another case, okay? So he became a photographer, became a videographer, and eventually ended up becoming a children's magician. And one thing that he told me, which I thought was really interesting, was he said, you have to let go before you can start something new. And in order to let go, you have to be able to prioritize. And I always find that moving on is generally harder than holding on. So you've got to try to figure out, well, what am I willing to let go of to make room for this other thing that I know is much more important to me? And that's where clarity is really important. The next important thing to do is to connect with people. So tonight's a great opportunity for you. So hang out with the crowd here a little bit after the talk today, and I don't know, try to meet three new people tonight, because what I think you'll find is that if you can hang out with the people who are doing the thing that you want to do or who share a similar aspiration to you, you will get where you want to go a lot quicker. And I think Jim Rohn is the one who said, you are the average of the five people you spend the most time with. So think about, who am I spending my time with right now? Gosh, do I want to be more like those people or not? And if you don't want to be, I see a few people chuckling, try to connect with people who are doing the things that you want to do. I found that sometimes one conversation can be a lot more productive and a lot more effective in helping me figure out where to go versus hours and hours of research that I do on my own or hours and hours of reflection on my own. So sometimes talking with somebody or getting a third party perspective on things or just hanging out with people who are doing different things can be really refreshing. So I'd encourage you to connect with more people. This woman here is Naz Nazawa. She is someone who used to be a marketer in San Francisco and has now started her own interior design company. She's doing really well right now. And one of the things that she told me was that you've got to try to seek knowledge outside of your immediate network. So we're talking about moving beyond your colleagues or your industry or your sector and trying to talk with people who are doing something totally different, because that helps kind of break the boundaries around what you think is possible. And that's what she did. She went and she talked to a bunch of interior designers. She asked them, hey, do I need to go back to school for this? Do I not need to go back for school? She just got a lot of information, and that really catalyzed her career change. Okay, so those are two ways you can gain some clarity. The second area that I think is so important is confidence. Okay, well, how do you get confidence? Because wouldn't we all like to be confident in our moves? Confidence is important not only for yourself, but also so that at some point you're going to have to pitch whatever you're trying to do, whether it's with a future employer or with your own entrepreneurial gig. At some point, you have to sell yourself and your ideas and what you want to do next to somebody, and that requires some confidence. So you got to have confidence in place. Well, how do you do that? Well, number one is to experiment. You dabble a little bit. Okay, you test the waters. And without putting too much pressure on yourself, I think sometimes what can happen is people say, well, this side hustle's got to turn into a full-time self-sustaining job within 1 year. And it's just like that hurdle is so daunting that it prevents you from ever moving on it. So what I would say is, well, try to experiment without any sort of attachment or expectation to the outcome, which I know is much harder to do than it sounds. I mean, easier said than done, right? I mean, you invest a lot of time. Of course, you're going to be invested in the outcomes. But if there's some way you can detach yourself from the outcome, just say, I'm going to experiment for the sake of experimenting to see what I uncover here, that can be really useful. Vicky Dane is based in London, and she's a former corporate lawyer in London who is now a clinical psychologist. And what she did was, well, she got kind of fed up with her day job of corporate law, and she eventually left it behind and just went and experimented. She did some fish. I mean, she'd saved up some money. She did some fishing for a while. She worked on a farm for a while. She got into carpentry. She worked in a bakery for a little while. And she just kind of dabbled. And she just kind of tested out the water. She tried to just do a lot of different things just to see what would stick with her. And eventually, she found herself really getting attached to the idea of counseling and clinical psychology. And she's in the midst of actually getting her, I think it's called a certification right now. So she's on her way to getting her clinical psychology certification. And what she said in the podcast was, get out there and try as many things as possible. Just, I mean, this is what you do as kids, right? But you kind of stop doing that once you're an adult. But just go out there and dabble. Come to a place like this, maybe take a course. Maybe take an evening course. Maybe take an online course with Udemy that's, I don't know, 10 pounds. It's like a low risk way of experimenting with some different ideas. Trust yourself. You're going to run into a lot of people who say that what you're doing doesn't make any sense. And you can imagine the people I ran into in medical school when I told them, hey, I don't know if this is quite for me. And I'm talking to all these people who said, well, God, you know, like, all of us have worked so hard to get here. What are you thinking? Like, why would you even consider leaving this behind? That's crazy. And by the way, you took up somebody else's spot here who could have come to this medical school. So you should feel really bad about yourself, too. Okay, so you're gonna have people who question what you're doing. But I would really encourage you to try to trust yourself, because ultimately, you're the one who's got to live with yourself every single day. And over time, the judgment you're going to be facing is mostly going to be coming from yourself. So Audrey Lamargue is someone who used to work in the cosmetics export industry. She's from France. And she was traveling all the time. And eventually, the travel kind of got to her. And she eventually ended up getting really interested in wellness. And she is now a naturopath. And she went to a school of naturopathy here in London. And what she said was, it didn't matter what others thought, because I knew this was the right move for me. She ran into a ton of people who said, well, what are you doing leaving your high-paid, jet-setting corporate job to go do this thing that may not even pay the bills one day? But actually, she knew this was going to make her really happy. And so it didn't matter what other people thought. So if you can get in that mindset of, hey, what matters the most is the key stakeholder is actually me, then it allows you to block off all these other distractions that might come up along the way. And there will be some that come up along the way. Final thing I want to talk about is courage. And I got three ideas here for you when it comes to amassing courage. And again, courage is what allows you to do the things that you can't do right now. Okay? It gives you the strength to go off and do something that you never thought was possible. First thing is take action. And I am someone by nature who likes to reflect a lot on stuff and kind of ruminate about things and think things through. At some point, you're going to have to take some action in order to move yourself forward, for sure. And those people who end up taking action are the ones who end up getting the farthest. Okay, so those people who are sitting next door who are learning how to code, They're on their first step toward maybe having a life as or whatever class they're teaching over there tonight, as being a coder, because that's something they want to do. Okay, they're taking that first step, so take action. This is Kelly Cara. She is based in Austin, Texas. She used to be an educational researcher working in a small cubicle at a university. She is now a vegan baker and a lifestyle wellness educator in Austin. And one of the things that she told me was, you eventually have to do something to make your change happen. And the story she tells in the episode is that she had thought about going to culinary school for so long. I mean, years she had thought about going to culinary school. And she said, if I were to win the lottery, what would I do? I would go to culinary school. And she would always talk about it, but she would never do anything about it. And one day she said, I got to actually do something about this. So she started to research vegan. She was really passionate about a vegan lifestyle. So she started to research, okay, well, what vegan, are there even vegan culinary schools out there? And she got on a newsletter list, and then she started getting their emails, and then she called them up, and next thing you know, she's enrolled in their course, and now she's doing this full time. And she told me that you just gotta take action at some point, otherwise nothing's gonna happen, okay? The next thing is to be patient. And this is where I get a little tripped up sometimes, where I launch something, and I expect it to kind of go viral right away, or you try to embark on some major change, and it doesn't quite work out as quickly as you would like it to. This happens a lot. I can't tell you how many times I've put something out there, whether it's an article or, even my TED Talk when I first gave it. I was really worried like nobody would actually end up watching my TED Talk. So you kind of had this sort of chirping crickets phenomenon that happens, and this happens to me all the time. But you gotta be patient, because change takes a lot of time. And it will rarely be an overnight success. This guy's name is Steven Satterfield. He's based in San Francisco. He used to be the restaurant manager for Nopa Restaurant in San Francisco, which is a really great restaurant. And the lifestyle of working in a restaurant was just really exhausting for him. But he still had a really big passion for food. So this is an example of somebody who made a tweak. He stayed in the industry and became a freelance writer. And now he founded a magazine called Whetstone Magazine, where he focuses on food origins stories. And what he said was, overnight successes do happen, but not very often. Okay, you hear about these every so often. These are the stories you always hear about, but the reality is they just don't happen that often. Normally, it is the result of laying down the new path, brick by brick, day by day, putting in your 20-mile march, as Jim Collins would say, and slowly but surely making your way to eventually get the breakthrough that you want. And those people who stick with it and are patient end up getting to the point where they actually turn the corner. And some people actually stop right before they're just about to turn a corner. So it's really important that you be patient with your career change. Again, easier said than done. The final point I'll make is, and this is my own thought here, which is just to try to find some inspiration. And I think inspiration is really important, because I think inspiration is basically the mental adrenaline of your life. I think inspiration is the mental adrenaline of your life. It allows you to do things that you didn't think were possible. It kind of kickstarts your energy. So when you hear a really inspiring story, it actually lets you think, wow, that's actually possible. Somebody out there is doing this. So inspiration can kind of feel really touchy-feely and soft, but I found that inspiration is something that keeps me propelling forward. So whether that is going online and watching some inspirational talks, or hanging out with somebody you find inspirational, or reading a blog online that you think is really inspirational. Listen to podcasts. I listen to a lot of podcasts that I find to be really clarifying and useful for my own career. So whatever it is, to try to find some point of consistent inspiration for yourself, because that's going to keep you going when you need it, and you will need it when you're trying to navigate your change. Okay, so inspiration is like mental adrenaline, so you want to have a lot of that. And just to kind of recap what we've covered, hopefully what you've gotten out of tonight is you get a sense of what a career change story could look like, what are some of the questions you might want to ask yourself to help you navigate those pivotal moments. You might have hopefully identified where you are on this roadmap or this trajectory of career change, and hopefully identify where you are on those 7 stages of career change so you can figure out what to do next. Some of the myths. Kind of understand what's involved with career change so you know what you're getting yourself into, and hopefully some concrete principles or ideas of how people approach this so you can approach it in a similar way, and hopefully eventually relaunch your own career. So we started tonight with this question, which is, what brave step am I willing to take to create the career and life I want? And the challenge I'd like to leave with you tonight is to try to take one brave step this week to create that career and life that you want. And I mean it. Don't wait till next week. Start this week. Because every day that goes by is another day. So just one small digestible step that will move you in a direction where you can look yourself in the eye in the mirror every morning and say, wow, I'm doing work that matters. I'm doing work that's meaningful for me. And it's definitely worth it. And so I think if you can take this action, then you can definitely have a meaningful career, and you can definitely create the life that you want, and you can have the positive impact, not only for yourself, but also the people around you, the world around you, and hopefully feel really satisfied with your overall career trajectory. And I think if you do that, then you'll have a more meaningful life, and you'll end up being much more satisfied each and every day. So that's all I've got for you tonight. So if you want to check out more episodes, or if you want to hear some of these people's full stories, I'd love for you to, the podcast is fairly new, I'd love for you to check out the podcast and subscribe. It's on iTunes and Stitcher and Android, so would love for you to subscribe and let me know what you think, and hopefully you find these stories to be useful for your own career trajectory. And maybe they could be a point of inspiration for you. This is my contact information. If you want to know more about the seven stages of career change, you can go to this URL, josephplew.com/roadmap. You can download a free roadmap for yourself, and it just gives you more details on each of the stages, some of the questions or exercises you can work through to try to get you to the next stage. And that's it. So this is my contact information. You can find me on Twitter. If you happened to take any pictures tonight, I would love for you to tweet them at me. It's always nice to have pictures from these events. And we'd love to stay in touch. So good luck to you. I hope that you found this useful, and I hope you will relaunch your careers. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Just go out and do it.
Yeah, I totally get it. So the question for those of you who didn't hear it is, so going back to this piece about having confidence, well, that sounds great, but the reality is you're going to be facing a lot of people who judge you and critique you, and especially if you're doing something that's very different from what you did before, and maybe the metrics for success are very different from those in the world that you're currently in. How do you deal with that? Because it's actually pretty tough. So yeah, all this stuff I'm talking about today, it's all really tough stuff, okay? It's not, because if it were tough, then there's this guy I follow on YouTube. His name is Brandon Carter. I follow him for my abs workout, okay? And he's like, he's got these like ripped abs. And he really says, if it was easy, everybody would do it, right? So if career change were easy, if it were easy to try to go pursue your dream career, everybody would do it, I guarantee you. The problem is it's really hard. So yes, so first thing is to acknowledge that it is actually quite hard. One of the things that I actually heard in the most recent episode, I interviewed somebody from Singapore who runs a school called the Change School. And one of the things that she did when she was navigating, which I think is hopefully relevant to this question, is she tried to identify, well, who are the people who actually do matter to me? And it might seem obvious to go through that, but to actually ask yourself the question, whose opinions do I truly care about? And hopefully it's not more than two or three. Because if it gets to be more than two or three, it becomes very hard to satisfy everybody. And I think in her case, it was her husband, and it wasn't even her parents. It was her husband, and I think it was it, and herself. And so if you can kind of hone in on, well, whose judgments do I truly care about? Who really does matter here? It'll help it be a little bit less daunting. And to try to find a way to, once you've decided that, okay, I'm only gonna try to put weight on these people's opinions, to do your best to kind of block out everybody else. But I get that it's easier said than done. So I think when I was making my transitions, I was primarily concerned with what I would find satisfying. And also I did want to make sure my wife was okay with it. Because I mean, I'm going into this world where I don't know if I can make ends meet. So I need her buy-in, just like you need like a buy-in of a stakeholder at work. Like, who are the key stakeholders in your life? And normally it's a couple. It's a handful maybe. So yeah, any other questions? Yeah, in the back there, yeah. Yeah, so the question is, okay, what happens if you get stuck in that mitigation phase, which happens a lot, and you're making these incremental changes, but none of those changes are significant enough to make you happy? Well, I guess the advice I give is to, first of all, take a close look inside and say, hey, are these, how long will I continue to make incremental changes? How long am I willing to continue to make incremental changes before I try something bigger? And just try to get a sense of what's your appetite for doing that. Also, the other thing to think about is the cost of time. Sometimes if you can get really close to this concept of the fragility of life and the fragility of time, it's like, okay, well, if I were not to make this move now, when would be a better time? And if you can't think of a better time in the future, and I'm not talking about ideal times, I'm talking about the times that are good enough. Sometimes getting clear on, like, when would the timing be best for something like this? Sometimes that can help you decide, okay, well, you know what, now is as good a time as any, I'm gonna go for this, and it's kind of now or never. So almost creating some urgency around it. The other thing I'd mention to you is if you are thinking about making a bigger change and you just haven't done it, there's a guy named Scott Britton who actually I used to listen to his podcast, which has sadly been discontinued, but he's got a great podcast called The Competitive Edge. And one of the things he talked about was getting leverage on yourself. And what he meant by that was, okay, if you, like, for example, one of the things I want to do is to launch an online course. And I did a podcast interview yesterday, actually, and he said, what's coming up? I said, well, I'm launching an online course at the end of May. But I haven't actually started it yet, okay? But I'm going to get it done by the end of May now, because I've now made this commitment publicly that I'm going to do it. So Scott talks about getting leverage on yourself, or like telling yourself or telling somebody else that you will do this so that there's no other way out of it. So that can be sometimes useful. Try to get some leverage on yourself. Yeah, so I think that that's true. I think that I'm giving examples of these people here who have publicly done this. I will say that the clients I work with, they're oftentimes people who don't have the luxury of either the, you know, mortgage to pay, kids to feed. I can't go off and do my own thing. So is there some sort of incremental change I can make? And so with those types of people, I would say what's important is, what are the things right now that are really intolerable to you? Like one or two things that you just can't have any more of anymore. And maybe you can replace one of those things with something else. You know, so it doesn't mean you gotta go off and, like I said, it doesn't have to be a drastic change. Maybe it can be a tweak. So you can change industries or change sectors or change jobs so you don't lose everything and you can kind of continue on in your trajectory. There are cases of people who do that and they end up being quite happy. So taking a close, kind of doing a little bit of a thermometer check on, like, of the different aspects of my job, whether it's manager comes up a lot, manager or culture or location or the product I'm selling or the work I'm doing. Normally one of those is the thing that's really getting to you. So if there's a way to pinpoint that and maybe switch that out and just try to replace that with something that might be more palatable to you, that can be a way. Yeah. Yes? Okay. Yeah, okay, so the question's around, how do you handle the emotional side of things? Because, yeah, there's the practical and there's the emotional, and actually the emotional is actually pretty tough to handle. And also, I think you asked about how do you handle anger, right? So anger management, wow, that's a whole other topic. I think the emotional side of it is first of all, just, I know this is going to sound like I'm dodging the question, but first of all, just acknowledging that it is a very emotional process. Like understanding that, hey, I'm gonna go through times where I'm really angry, and I'm gonna go through times where I feel a tremendous sense of loss. And having some way of acknowledging that and dealing with it, I think, is really important. So, I guess if it's anger, then I guess the question to ask yourself is, how is that anger serving you right now? Because you're probably hanging on to that anger for some reason, because it's doing something for you. It is serving you in some way, otherwise you wouldn't be angry. And normally it's things like, well, it makes me feel like, I don't know, it makes me be able to get some steam off my chest, or it makes me just feel like I can just finally get everything off of my chest that I've been meaning to say, and the world needs to hear this. I mean, whatever, I'm just making up some examples, but like, how is that anger serving you? And do you think it's going to continue serving you? And how much is it serving you in your aspirations to move on to the next thing? So I actually think things like anger and loss and depression can be really useful. But at some point, it stops serving you. And so I think either getting clear on that with yourself, or maybe working with somebody to help you understand, is this emotion really serving me well? And if so, at what point do I need to replace it with another emotion, maybe, that would be more productive for me, given where I want to go. So I actually think it's useful to let yourself feel what you're feeling, because otherwise, if you try to rush through these stages, what ends up happening is people end up regressing pretty quickly. It goes back to the whole thing about, like, loss. I mean, if people try to move too quickly through the denial phase, then they just end up back there months later. So, yeah. Yeah. Well, I do think there is a purely practical element to this also. I do think there probably is a limit to how many career changes you can make before it becomes difficult to sell your narrative to people. So I'm not going to stand here and say, yeah, you can make any career change you want, it's going to work out okay. I think, I mean, I do some work at business schools, for example, and so I work with MBAs, and sometimes their backgrounds are so scattered that it's hard to create a clear narrative. So I do think that if you change too much, there are some risks to that, for sure. There are some trade-offs to that. Now, with that said, I think if you're trying to kind of figure out where to go and you're not quite sure, I actually do think that it's useful to try to start somewhere and like focus on the priority interests that you have as sort of an anchor point. I know that sounds kind of vague because I'm not quite sure which industry you're in, but I think that if you can focus in on like what is it that I must have in my career, even broadly speaking, it doesn't have to be a specific industry or a sector, but like what are the characteristics of what I would think would create a really great job for me or a great career for me, and start there and kind of take a top-down approach and kind of see what fits. Sometimes people take a little bit more of a, I don't know how to put it, more systematic approach, where they think about things like, okay, what's my passion? What am I good at? What can I make a decent living on? What is feasible for me? And they'll look at those four things and they'll kind of rank the different potential paths they can go into as kind of a more systematic way. So a bit of a grid analysis, if you will. I generally actually don't think that most people know exactly what they want to do. I actually, from what I've found, is people kind of broadly know, but they don't always really know. And so I also think it's okay to have multiple interests. I think these days it's okay to have a portfolio career, but just know that when you do that, it becomes a little bit harder for people to make sense of you. And so one of the things I work on with people is personal branding, and so being able to control that narrative and tell a narrative that makes sense logically, I think that's a practical constraint when it comes to career change. So it's something to think about. Go ahead, yeah. We'll take like one more here, yeah, and then if we have one more after this, and then we'll probably wrap it up. Yeah. The question was around, well, what happens if I leave the corporate world and I used to have that cushy job title and also the immediate recognition and credibility that comes when you work for a recognizable brand or company, and now I'm by myself and I don't have any brand, and now it's just me. That it's tough, actually. I think it's really tough. I mean, that was one of the rude awakenings for me when I went off on my own was, okay, you go from working for Goo and Haagen-Dazs, and everybody knows those brands here, to like, nobody's even heard of me. And so I think it's a little bit of trying to define, well, what is the unique space that you want to operate in? And being quite specific about it. I think that the more specific you can be, the better, because people will know what to do with you and they'll kind of know how to make sense of you. So I think it's useful to take stock of, okay, well, if I think about the past experiences I've had and what I want to do, is there some intersection between the two so that I can be credible in a particular space where people can kind of take me seriously? And you just try to build it up one piece at a time. I mean, where I started was I kind of combined my past brand marketing experiences with coaching, and that intersection seems to have worked for me, but I didn't really know if that was going to work or not. But at least I knew that I could be credible in that space, and I think that's the major issue people have when they're going off on their own. I mean, most of the people I work with now, if I'm hiring people to do things, like I work with a producer and an animator and sound guy and musician and stuff for the podcast, these are all freelancers, so I hear a lot about the freelance world. And it's hard to kind of, getting that first client's really tough. And so, but I think, you know, just build it up piece by piece. And you remain somewhat open to the idea that your job title that you call yourself right now might evolve into something else. And that at the end of the day, yes, job titles do matter because it allows people to know what to do with you. But also, I mean, I can't remember if I even said my job title. I think I put it up here. I put career consultant, but I mean, I don't even know what to call myself sometimes. So it's tricky. I mean, I wish I had a better answer for you, but I think what I see a lot these days is when people are doing multiple things, they try to find, I mean, in branding, we kind of talk about there being an umbrella brand or like a mega brand. And is there something that can unify everything that you're doing under one particular phrase that can kind of be a catch-all for all the different strands of work that you're doing? That can sometimes work. So. But yeah, it's not easy. It's tough, actually. I think it's one of the toughest things going on here. All right, we'll take one more here, and then I'll let you guys mingle amongst yourselves. So the question was around, what are the daily rituals or tasks or things that I do to help keep me on track? And so generally, I'm trying to think what I do to stay on track. You know, I'm a big believer. I alluded to this earlier, and I think I'll tell you about the concept first. And I'll get more specific about what I do. There's a great book out there called Great by Choice by Jim Collins, and he talks about this concept of the 20-mile march. And the 20-mile march is what he does in the book is he compares teams that succeed versus teams that don't succeed, and he talks about these two teams that are trying to climb Mount Everest, and one team makes it and one team doesn't make it. And by not making it, like, they all die. Okay, and what was the difference between the two teams? The difference was, the team that perished, on the good days, they went really, really far. And on the bad days, they just completely sat it out. But what happened was there were a lot of bad days. And so they started to burn through their food supply really quickly. And on the good days, they went so far that they exhausted themselves. And so the team that made it, they said, every day, no matter what, on a good day or a bad day, I'm going to go 20 miles. And every single day, we're going to go 20 more miles. And they ended up making it. And what that translates into for your own life, whatever you're trying to do, is there some small step that you can make, that you can commit to making every single day, that will eventually get there, that will eventually help you get there? So I'm a big believer in the 20-mile march. And so one of the things that I do to stay on track is I'm kind of a lists guy. I know not everybody is, but just to get really specific here, I use a couple apps. One's called Wunderlist. The other one's called Trello. And I use Trello more as a visual post-it note board. It also helps me work with the virtual teams I work with. And Wunderlist is for myself, and I give everything a deadline. And so that it doesn't just sit there. And if I don't do it within a certain amount of time, I just dump it into a do later box. And I actually look at Wunderlist and Trello every single day. It's the first thing I do, actually. I know it sounds really geeky, but it's like the first thing I do when I wake up and I start working each day. The other thing I do is I really do commit to whatever you want to call it. I mean, generally for me, it's like a 9 to 7 day, because in the middle of the day, I actually take a quick break and try to get some exercise in. I kind of gloss over that, but that's actually a really big part of it, is like making sure you're staying fit yourself, because it takes a lot of endurance to make a career change. So taking care of yourself is really important. So I try to make a commitment to exercise every single day. But I generally work like 9 to 7 every day, and I don't really budge on that. I try to put a new episode of the podcast out every 2 to 3 weeks, and I try not to let that slide too much. And so I try to just be productive around the things that I know are hopefully making a difference out there. And like I said, the other thing that keeps me on track, and I mentioned this before, is just that inspiration piece. So I do make a point to try to listen to, I used to listen to The Competitive Edge a lot because I think it's a fantastic podcast, but he's actually launched a new company called Troops, so he's busy with that now. But I would try to find, the nice thing about podcasts is it comes out regularly, so you can listen to them regularly. So creating some cadence of inspiration for yourself, I think, is really important. And that helps keep me going. And then the final thing is just to remember why you're doing it. And this is not my concept. This is something that Tony Robbins talks about. It's like to remember your why, your W-H-Y. Like why, like what, putting aside the day-to-day tasks, like why am I doing this? Like what am I in this for? What am I trying to accomplish? And if you can kind of reconnect with why you're doing it, that can be a way of keeping you on track. Thank you so much for coming, everybody, and good luck. All right, thanks a lot.